Carbon dioxide is a reactant in the process of photosynthesis and a product of cellular respiration. Plants take in carbon dioxide from the atmosphere and use it as a source of carbon for the sugars they produce, such as glucose. Sunlight captured by the plant during photosynthesis is stored as chemical potential energy within the glucose molecules made by the plants. Photosynthesis and cellular respiration are important components of the carbon cycle. As a result of the process, carbon is exchanged between living things and the non-living environment. Do plants perform cellular respiration in addition to photosynthesis? This is photosynthesis. Plant cells respire the same way animal cells do, but respiration is only one part of the process. To survive, plants carry out another form of chemical reaction called photosynthesis. While both plants and animals carry out cellular respirations, only plants conduct photosynthesis to make their own food. This is why they're referred to as producers. Cellular respiration is a chemical reaction plants need to get energy from glucose. Respiration uses glucose and oxygen to produce carbon dioxide and water and release energy. Do plants affect carbon dioxide concentration differently in light and dark environments? Today, you will explore this question by replicating the phenomenon in a closed system. For this investigation, we will need a wireless CO2 sensor, a sampling bottle to represent our closed system, a sheet of aluminum foil, a light source. I'll be using this LED flashlight. You'll also need a couple spinach leaves. Leaves perform photosynthesis at a higher rate when they are least stressed. So to reduce the stress, float a single layer of spinach leaves face up in a shallow pan filled with water for about 20 minutes or so prior to your investigation. Then you'll want to blot them dry before you place them into the sample bottle. To start, I'm going to select sensor data in SparkView and make sure that my CO2 sensor is connected to my device, which it is. And for this investigation, you're going to want to choose the line graph display so I can see CO2 concentration over time. Then what you want to do before you get started is to calibrate your CO2 sensor. And you do that by putting it inside the bottle. And at the bottom left here, I just click on that and click calibrate measurement. And that's it. That's all you have to do. So now the CO2 sensor is calibrated. All right, then we need to get a good spinach leaf here. I'm going to blot it dry and put it into a sampling bottle. And you can use a pencil or something if you have it on hand to get it in there. And then I'm going to secure the system with a CO2 sensor. Make sure your leaf is face up. After putting the sensor back into the bottle, we want to make sure we have a good seal, and I'm going to let it sit there for about a minute before we get started. And you'll notice that I'm going to take my light and put it directly over the spinach leaf. So this is going to be your setup. All right, so let's start collecting data. We need to collect data for 5 minutes, and we'll speed that up for you. So here we go. Let's get started. Okay. All right, so stop collecting data after the 5 minutes and scale the graph if necessary. Just click those cross bars right there. You're going to want to sketch this data into graph one. Label both axes and include units and a scale. Identify the data run as light in the key. Next, use the SparkView tools to identify the starting and ending CO2 concentrations and to enter those values into table one. Finally, calculate the change in the CO2 concentrations by subtracting the initial CO2 concentration from the final CO2 concentration and enter the results in table one. Pause the video now to complete these steps. Okay, now we will move to part two and investigate how leaves behave in darkness. We want to keep the system closed, but now I'm going to wrap the bottle up in the aluminum foil that we had. got a good seal there. And then, since the only thing we're changing now is putting the leaf in darkness, I'm going to keep my light up on the top just to control that. All right, I'm gonna let the system rest this way for about a minute. So while we do this, make a prediction. What do you think will happen to the CO2 level in the bottle while the leaves are in the dark? Wonder what could happen. All right, so let's start part two. I'm gonna start recording data again, and we're gonna collect it for another 5 minutes, but don't worry, we'll speed that up for you. Okay, it's been 5 minutes, so I'm gonna stop recording data. And now you're gonna wanna sketch this graph and onto graph one. Identify the data run as dark in the key, identify the starting and ending CO2 concentration levels, and enter that information into table one. Finally, calculate the change in the CO2 concentrations by subtracting the initial CO2 concentration from the final CO2 concentration and enter the result in table one. Pause the video now to complete these steps. During data collection, you are asked to identify the starting and ending CO2 concentration points. To do this, all you have to do is utilize the coordinate tool within SparkView to pull that data. So what I'm going to do is I'm just going to pick the first run, which was our light run, click on that starting point and the coordinates tool, and that tells me what my starting concentration was, 442 parts per million. And then you can do the same here at the end to pull that number, 220. Review the introduction part of the video, as well as your data, to answer the questions found in your student handout.